You're listening to the audio production of When Making Others Happy is Making You Miserable, How to Break the Pattern of People-Pleasing and Confidently Live Your Life by Karen Ehman. Published by Zondervan and read by the author. Lisa Turnkirst's foreword read by Jenny Welsh. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
To Ruth and Pat, for the ways you please God and love people.
Foreword by Lisa Turnkirst. I would love to say that I don't struggle with keeping others happy so I can feel happy, but sadly, that's not true. I remember the first time someone labeled my struggle as people-pleasing. I was caught off guard and, quite honestly, offended. I love people really well. I mean, they know they can count on me day and night. It makes me feel awful to say no. It makes me feel great to be the one who says yes. I know I'm a little tired, but as long as I'm doing this from a good heart, it's good, right? And it was that very misguided thought process that proved how much I needed a wise friend like Karen to help me make some changes. In Matthew chapter 22, verses 37 to 39, we find some of Jesus' most popular words. Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself." Love God. Love people. Karen has helped me realize that there is a priority in this instruction. Priority is what I've been missing. For years, I've said yes to requests even when I didn't have the capacity or the desire to do what others were asking of me. And if I'm really honest, it often wasn't purely out of love for people that I would stretch myself way too thin. It was because I couldn't figure out how to manage the fear of what disappointing them would cost me. So constantly trying to win the approval of others left me feeling empty and exhausted. And that's when my friend Karen helped me reorient my priorities. It's not love people so that they reassure you that you are loved. No, it's first love God and live from that assured place that you are already loved. Then from that confident and compassionate state of mind, love people in appropriate ways that don't hyperextend yourself constantly. You're in safe company if you find yourself in the same struggle. Karen is warm and hilarious and inviting and oh so tender-hearted, but she loves you way too much to let you stay in a place where making other people happy is making you miserable. Let's be honest about what this is really costing us. Let's admit how it might be taking the best of us away from those who should be a priority. Let's acknowledge how helpless we feel when we're overcommitted time and time again. Let's dare to be brave enough to make changes. Let's rise up and model how healthy it is to break away from pleasing people so we can truly love people without a hidden agenda. And let's learn to have enough space and quiet and calm to totally step into our one glorious life and truly live.
Chapter 1. The Prison of People-Pleasing. Spotted on a sweatshirt. You can't please everyone. You're not pizza. Am I now trying to win the approval of human beings or of God? Or am I trying to please people? If I were still trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Christ. Galatians 1:10. I grabbed a handful of tissues and dashed out the sliding glass door that leads to our back deck. It was a muggy Midwest afternoon in late May. My body would have much rather been inside the frosty air conditioning. However, my mind desperately needed to escape, to somewhere, anywhere, and since my son was using my vehicle to go to work that day, I couldn't go very far. I plopped myself down in a lawn chair at the wooded portion of our back property near our fire pit. I'd sat in that bright blue chair through hundreds of baseball games, cheering my sons on as they were stepping up to the plate to bat, or perched on pitcher's mound, ready to hurl a curveball. Perhaps now I could cheer myself up, but I doubted it. Nothing about my situation or my near future looked even remotely cheery to me. My best friend from college and I had just wrapped up a phone call. We've been in each other's lives for over a quarter century, and she continually has my best interests at heart. A chat with her is a delight in my day, a major pick-me-up. In fact, once we finish, I'll hang up and think, man, talking to her is almost better than church. We've processed life together since we were both teenagers. We've prayed for each other's marriages, shared our mothering mishaps, and navigated how best to help our aging parents. We offer each other encouragement and advice, or simply listen to the other share something trivial, laughing while on speakerphone as we each frantically try to get supper on the table. But this phone call was different. Although my friend didn't know it, when we ended the call, I wasn't feeling cheered up or churched up at all. I was feeling utterly defeated and emotionally exhausted. Oh, it wasn't something she'd said that sent me to this dismal place. Not at all. Well, then what had sent me over the edge, threatening to drain the happiness from my heart and send fretfulness filling up my soul? It was something I had done dozens, maybe hundreds. Oh, come on, let's be honest, probably thousands of times. I had said yes. Our family had moved to a tiny town just outside Lansing, the capital of my home state of Michigan. Her college-age son was in the process of interviewing for a summer internship at an organization in the city. She'd called to inform me that he'd just accepted a position and would soon be working just down the interstate, about 15 minutes from our new home. The job description fit him to a T, and he was pumped about starting soon. However, this job was going to require more than an hour commute each way from his home near Detroit. Most days, it wouldn't be a problem, as he'd be working a typical 9-to-5-ish day. However, some days, he would be responsible for staying late and closing up, getting home near midnight. Yet, he would still need to be up for work at oh dark o'clock the next morning. Knowing this would be the occasional situation for him, maybe a day or two a week, she asked if he could spend the night with us on those nights, sleeping in our guest room. Now, this guy was no trouble at all. We've known him his entire life. He was loads of fun, utterly respectful, and kind. So who he was had exactly zero to do with a little conversation that commenced inside my mind. This convo was between outward me and inward me. It is a discussion that my brain has hosted gazillions of times. Here's how it went that day. Inward me. Oh no, I'm not sure about this. I think we have too much going on this summer to have an overnight guest stay a couple days each week. I should say no. Outward me. But if you say no, you'll disappoint your friend, who is just wanting a little help for her son. Inward me. I know, but it just doesn't feel right. I have so much on my plate, both at home and in my ministry. I should say no. Outward me. But if you say no, you're also going to let down your friend's son as well. That is two people you will disappoint. Besides, he's such a great guy. You should help him out. He won't be any trouble at all. Inward me. I know how I am. I'll want to make sure his room has clean sheets and fresh towels, and I'll stay up at night until he gets here and make him something to eat before he goes to bed. Although I usually love being hospitable, this is going to stress me right out. Outward me. Oh, come on. You are the master multitasker. You can juggle a myriad of things at once. This one little addition won't be a big deal. Just shuffle some things around on that big old plate of yours. You can make it all fit. Inward me. Oh, dear. My mind is starting to race and my heart's beating faster. I'm still dealing with the death of my dad. And my stepmom, mother-in-law, and mother, who are all getting up there in age, sometimes need my help. And we have a new house that we still are remodeling. In fact, the guest room is piled high with wood planks for the new floors that won't get installed for weeks. And I'm a brand new mother-in-law. I need to carve out time to spend with my new daughter. Oh, and I almost forgot. A family friend just texted a few days ago to ask if they can stay at our house some weekends to help jumpstart a new career as a personal shopper, by picking up some clients in the city. I'd already answered yes to that request. Oh, what was I thinking? How am I ever going to manage all of this? Outward me. Girlfriend, chill out. You can totally handle it. What you cannot handle is failing to accommodate your friend. That will feel way worse than being stressed. Now listen, you have a choice. It's either disappoint her or slightly inconvenience yourself. You know the right answer, just say yes. Inward me, I shouldn't. Outward me, you must. Inward me, I really shouldn't. Outward me, oh, but you must. Inward me, no, I'm pretty certain I shouldn't. Outward me, oh, stop kidding yourself. You know that you will. And then outward me opened wide her big mouth and let out a resounding, sure, no problem. Meanwhile, inwardly, my spirit deflated just as quickly as my stress level skyrocketed. And so I ended the call, mumbling something about needing to switch over the laundry. Instead, I left the laundry untouched, reached for some antacids to remedy my ever-growing ulcer, and headed outside to bawl my freaking eyes out. How did I get here? Few people are completely immune from people-pleasing. The majority of us have said something we didn't really mean just because we didn't want to hurt someone else's feelings. You know, when your friend asked you what you thought about her new, trendy, neon blue jumpsuit that she was simply crazy about, but that you thought was about two sizes too small and made her look like an overstuffed Smurf? Inwardly, you may have thought it was closer to awful than awesome, but you summoned a smile and out of your mouth tumbled a counterfeit compliment. Wow, it looks so great! Why do we say things we don't really mean? It isn't limited to our desire to avoid hurting someone else's feelings. On many occasions, it is wound up in our longing to be liked. Who among us, if we were still in high school and faced with a choice between being an outstanding athlete yet having zero friends, or an utter klutz on the field but the recipient of the homecoming crown, would go for the star athlete status? Excuse me, please, while I straighten my tiara. Most of us have adopted the practice of saying or doing that which placates others in order to keep conflict at bay. Or we may not speak honestly due to a suspicion that we might be challenged. Oh, and how about this one? We simply don't feel like being bothered right now, and if we just agree with them, maybe they will go delightfully away. All legit reasons for sure. However, sometimes it goes much deeper. We might fib just a tad to a superior at work so that they will have a favorable view of us, especially if our potential rise in the company is something on which they have input. Or maybe it is birthed out of an earnest sympathy. When someone has experienced repeated disappointments or walked through a dire tragedy, to avoid adding to their sadness, we don't say anything that might upset them. Perhaps the most serious scenario is this: someone caught in a domestic abuse situation. Such an individual will say what the abuser wants to hear, regardless of what they really think or feel. They cannot risk upsetting the abusive person, so they take the brunt of their anger. When you drill down to unearth the causes of people-pleasing, you discover that it isn't just the response of the person we're hoping to make happy that causes us to give in and placate. For some of us, it is a result of how we are hardwired, a product of our particular personality. Although I won't go deep into specific personality tests and theories, since there are oodles of great works available, see my favorites in the resource section in the accompanying PDF, I do think some commonalities exist when it comes to the type of person who is in danger of becoming addicted to the approval of others. She may be the helpful sort, with kindness in her heart and the most patient of personalities. She truly enjoys assisting others. It's second nature for such a woman to step over a line and help beyond what is healthy or needful.
Another category.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.